Which of the following is an allowed combination of quantum numbers? You have 4 plus half, 5, 6, 2 plus half, 3, 2, 0 plus half, 2, 0, 1 minus half. Which of these has a possible combination of quantum numbers? Now, let's listen. Note that this is the principal quantum number. This is the magnet, the angular momentum. This is the magnetic, and this is the spin. Note that the spin quantum number can only two form, which are plus half and minus half. So everything here are correct. Now you should know that on no account must your L, which is the azimuthal quantum number, be the same with your N. On no account must your L be the same with what? N. That means this option is wrong. On no account must your N be the same as what? L. But your L can be the same as what? ML. Secondly, on no account must your L be greater than N. L must be less than N. So because on no account was that this is out. Another thing is, let's look at this one. This one, our N is 3, correct. L is 2. This is less than this. ML is 0. It is either this is equal to or less than, and 0 is less than 2, and plus half is what? The spin quantum number. It can either be plus half or minus half. This is correct. Now let's look at this. On no account must your ML be greater than your L. So ML must not be greater than what you have here as L. So this is wrong. So you see that as you are going, it increases in value. This must be greater than this, and for any means, this should either be equal to this or greater than. On no account must this be greater than this, and this can either be half, minus half, or plus half. Let me take it again. This must be greater than this. This must be greater than this or equal to this. On no account must this be greater than this, and this can only take value of plus half and minus half. So your correct answer is this, which is option C. Option C. Now, what is the wavelength of an electron with velocity 4.5? We are asked for the wavelength. The velocity is given as 4.52 times 10 raised to the power 3 meter per second. What is the wavelength of an electron with velocity? We ask for the wavelength. So how do you prefer a solution to this question? You know that your V is equals to F lambda, but you don't know your F, you don't know your frequency, so you can't prefer a solution to it. Now let's use this formula. There's a formula that says that your lambda to H over MV. Here H is a constant, which is the Planck's constant, 6.62 times 10 raised to the power minus 34 joule second. M is the mass of the electron, 9.1 times 10 raised to the power minus 11. And the V is what is given to you. Okay, this is minus 31 kg. And V is what is given to you as 4.52 times 10 raised to the power of 3. So substituting into this equation, what are you going to have? You have your lambda is equals to 6.62 times 10 raised to the power of minus 34 divided by M is 9.1 times 10 raised to the power of minus 31 times 4.52 times 10 raised to the power of 3. Now, when you simplify that, you are going to have a particular value. I'm not here with my calculator, but when you simplify that, you are going to have this 1, 2, 3. When you simplify that, you are going to have 0.1609 times 10 raised to the power of minus 7. Times 10 raised to the power of minus 7. That's what you are going to have all in meter. Use your calculator. I don't have a calculator here. But when you simplify that, this is what it's going to give to you. So to convert this to nanometer, please note, to convert 0.1609 times 10 raised to the power of minus 7 to nanometer, from meter, you multiply by 10 raised to the power of 9. Please note, to convert to nanometer from meter, you multiply by 10 raised to the power of 9. Why to convert from nanometer to meter, you divide by 10 raised to the power of 9. So multiplying, this gives us 160.9 nanometer. The most important thing you should know is that lambda is equal to h over mv. This is the de Broglie wavelength. It's called de Broglie wavelength. When Louis de Broglie in 1924 postulated the wave particle nature of light and wave particle duality, that is the wave-like nature and the particulate nature of light. We're going to look at that later times. All these are constant. Please memorize the constant. Our Planck's constant h has values of 6.62 times 10 raised to the power of minus 34. The mass of the electron is a constant also. It will be given to you. And that value is 9.1 times 10 raised to the power minus 31 kg. Now the velocity given to you in the question is 4.52 times 10 raised to the power of 3. Substitute into the equation, use your calculator to get here, and you get 0.160 times 10 raised to the power minus 7 meter. Converting from meter to nanometer, you multiply by 10 raised to the power of 9. That is your correct answer to that question. D, option D. Now we have the next question. The next question says, which properties of alkaline earth metal decreases with increasing atomic weight? Which properties of the alkaline earth metal decreases with increasing atomic weight? Now note, atomic radius. Now when they say the alkaline metal, what do they mean? They mean a particular group in the periodic table, which are the group 2 alkaline earth metal, the group 2 element, isn't it? So they are trying to get the trends in the periodic table. If you are aware of the trend, just for you to impute it, which of the trends decreases than the group? Which of the trends decreases than the group? Which of the trends decreases than the group? Of course, you know atomic radius increases than the group. True or false? Yeah. As more shells are added, the size of the atom what gets bigger. Atomic radii is the same thing. Ionic radii is the same thing as the atomic radii. The atomic number increases, right? It does not decrease. For example, you have beryllium, atomic number 4. Magnesium, atomic number 12. So calcium, atomic number 20. So you see that as you go down, it was increasing by 8. 4 plus 8, 12. 12 plus 8, 20. Like that. Then we have ionization energy. Yes, the ionization energy decreases. What's the ionization energy? The ionization energy is defined as the energy that is given off when an atom gives out electrons to form a positively charged ions. Are we getting it? Or the energy that must be broken or absorbed or given up in order for an atom to form a positively charged ion, isn't it? So as you go down, what happens? The size of the atom increases. And as the size of the atom increases, the effective nuclear charge decreases. What we are saying is that as you go down, let's say this is an atom, this is the nucleus, positively charged. If the electrons are here, what will happen? The force of attraction between this positive and these electrons will be very, very much. And as the force of attraction is much, what happens? The atoms are tied close to themselves, more like a boyfriend and girlfriend relationship. What happens? If they are close, what happens? They are tied together. So you need more energy. Are you getting it now? You need more energy to actually break them apart. You need to buy her Ferrari, buy her Bond Street, buy her all manner of things. True or false? True, because they are close together. So smaller atoms have very large effective nuclear charge between the center nucleus, which is positively charged, and the electron. While larger ones, for instance, let's say this is an atom. This is the proton. Then this is the electron. Of course, you know, inside you have other electrons. So what happened? This positive charge here, because of the other electrons that are surrounding it here, before the effect of this positive charge will get to this outer electron, it must have what? Weakened. So it will be very, very easy for this one to be what? Taken away. So the energy that you need to take this one away, which is the loosely bounded what? Electron from an atom, the energy that you need to take that loosely bounded electron is very, very what? Small energy. It's very, very what? Small what? Energy. Are we getting it now? All like this. So it's just like this one now. The father, the boyfriend is to the girlfriend. What happened? The easier it is for another guy to come and take her away. True or false? Same thing is what is applicable here. The father, the electron is from the center of the nucleus. The easier or the less energy that is required. And you know that from top to bottom, the size of the atom continually what increases. It's just like a polygamous family, let's say a man and a woman. Now, at the top, you have those small electrons. Isn't it all small size family, the bond is very tight. As you go down, what happens? Polygamy begins to what happens or takes place, isn't it? What happens? The love wins. So in that polygamous family, it's very easy for one of the women to say, I'm tired of the issues, I'm tired of the maltreatment here, and let me easily what go. It's very easy for you to drag her away. So you see that as you go down, the energy that you require to remove person from that family size actually what decreases. This one, you need much energy for you to separate a single man and his wife. This one, you need the medium energy. But as you get down here, this one that the family is big, you can easily come, pick one of the wife and what, go. Same thing is applicable. As you go down, the ionization energy what decreases. So it is very easy for you to pick and go. Are we getting it now? Ionization energy is the energy that you must what? Exact, that is involved or released when an atom, are we getting it? Or the energy that is involved when an atom gives outward electrons to form a positively charged ion. Is that clear here? So the correct answer is ionization energy. Now we have the next question. The next question says, in the Lewis dot structure of OF2 molecule, the number of lone pairs of electrons around the central oxygen is now you have OF2. The Lewis dot structure for OF2. How do you write Lewis dot structure? Let me explain this once and for all now. To write the Lewis dot structure, what do we do? OF2. Like I said, that in Lewis dot structure, you have the central atom. That means the atom at the center of the world structure. The central atom is the least electronegative atom. Now, between oxygen and fluorine, which one is least electronegative? Of course, you know it's oxygen, because fluorine is one of the most electronegative atoms in the periodic table. Are we getting all the most electronegative even? So whenever you see fluorine bonded to any other atom, fluorine is usually the more electronegative and the atom is the least electronegative. So oxygen is the least electronegative, so oxygen will be in the middle. Now, how many electrons does oxygen have? Oxygen has what? 6 electrons. Fluorine is in what group in the periodic table? Fluorine is in group 7. And since fluorine is in group 7, fluorine needs one electron. Okay, since fluorine is in group 7, fluorine has 7 valence electrons. Note that in Lewis dot structure, the electrons that we make use of are the valence electron. Fluorine is in group 7, and hence fluorine needs 7 valence. It has 7 valence electrons. How many electrons does it need to complete its atomic shell? It needs 1. Are we getting it now? Now, because it needs 1 electron, oxygen will give 1 electron to this one, fluorine atom. So fluorine is having 7, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Plus the 1 from the oxygen makes it 8. Now, another fluorine atom, we have 2 fluorine atoms. Oxygen we donate to the other fluorine atom also. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and what? 7. Oxygen has used 2 electrons to bond with fluorine. And we said oxygen has a total of how many electrons? 6 electrons. So how many electrons do we need to make oxygen 6? It has given us 2. 6 minus 2 is how many? 4. So it has 4 electrons. Now, the 4 electrons they will pair to give a lone pair. So to give us the lone pair, we divide by 2. So how many lone pairs of electrons? 2 lone pairs of electrons. So the lone pairs of electrons on the central oxygen atom are 2. So we have 2 lone pairs on the central oxygen atom. Now the question will come. How many pairs of electrons, lone pairs, are in the atom, the entire molecules rather? How many lone pairs are in the entire molecule? Now, when they say how many lone pairs are in the entire molecule, what they mean is how many lone pairs are in the fluorine atom and the oxygen atom alike. Now, you agree with me, the lone pairs of electrons are those non-bonding electrons, the ones that didn't go into bonding. This is a lone pair of electrons here because it didn't go into bonding. This is another lone pair. So we have 1, 2, 3. This is not a lone pair because it's bonded with oxygen. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So for the central atom, we have 2 lone pair. Why for the entire molecule, we have what? 8 lone pair. Now we ask for the central atom, and the correct answer is option 2. Option C, which is 2. Which of the following is a positive charge? Now, this is a very simple question. Which of the following is a positive charge? The correct answer is what? Proton. Proton is a positive charge. Next question. Rutherford carried out an experiment in which a beam of alpha particles were detected at a thin piece of gold foil. From the experiment, he concluded that. Now, we established that Rutherford and his team, Gegamula and Marsden, carried out an experiment. Whereby, alpha particles were bombarded against a thin gold foil. At the end of the experiment, it was concluded that the atom is it contains mostly of an empty space. But there is a central nucleus, which is very heavy and small, and contains most of the mass of the atom. There is a central nucleus, which is very tiny, but is dense and heavy, and contains most of the mass of the atom. That the atom is an empty space, but there is a central nucleus, which is very tiny, heavy, and dense, and contains most of the mass of the atom. These were the conclusion that was made from Rutherford's alpha particles experiment with his team, Gegamula and Marsden. Are we getting it now? So, the correct option here is option C. The positively charged particles are extremely small and extremely heavy-walled particles. That is the correct answer. Every other thing there is.